We'll see how that goes too. But so we're going to talk about church essentials over the next 4 weeks. The first one is on prayer. We're going to talk about being a disciple, which we've heard that many, many times. We're going to talk about money, giving. And the last one, I think, is about evangelism. But maybe I was wrong on that one. But anyway, Andrew is going to be teaching next 2 weeks. And I'll come back on the 30th, I think, maybe. It depends on how vacation goes. We might come back or we might not. You know, it's going to, you know, have fun. So we're not going anywhere really super special. We're going to Virginia and spending some time there in some of the Civil War little towns and kind of stuff. And we're going to enjoy that. Actually, just get away for about a week. So anyway, praise the Lord. So the first church essential, we can't do anything without prayer.
Amen.
Amen, saints? Come on, we can't do anything. We kind of can pretend we're a Christian. We can kind of show up to church. We can kind of do the motions. But there's no power. There's no effect in our lives if we're just going through the motions. We need God's power in our lives. We need God's prayer. And prayer does a lot of things, not only for ourselves individually, but the prayer affects the whole country, the whole world.
Yes.
Matter of fact, when you pray here, you could be praying for somebody overseas, and God, the effects of that prayer can be manifested overseas. One of my earliest stories as a believer was when a missionary, I love when missionaries come to visit us and share their story about things that they're doing. One of my earliest remembrance of a missionary coming to our church, and every time a missionary starts talking about, you know, being overseas in other countries and sharing the gospel and being persecuted for Christ and things happening, I'm like a big baby. I just cry, you know, because I pray for them, and so I'm like, I'm there. And I remember the missionary was sharing about a time they were coming, I think it was in Cambodia, and they were coming across the border, and they were going, it was at night, and they left late because the truck broke down, so they had to fix the truck. You know, they were driving down this dark road, or dirt road, and they had to get to the compound, and they were behind, and of course they got stopped with a bunch of people with guns and wanted to take whatever they had and maybe kill them. But as they were confronted, the missionary felt this peace come over him. So they're on this dirt road in the jungle, you know, you can't see nothing, lights are flashed on them, and all of a sudden the missionary just says, you know, like, I'm gonna die here. But at that moment, there's this peace came over him, like everything was gonna be fine. He didn't know what it was. And as they just started pulling forward in the truck, the guys with the guns just kind of just stepped aside and let him through. There's like six or seven of them. And they just drove slow. And as they got past them, then they just took off, you know. And they didn't know what happened. But it was like a year later, they found out from one of those guys that had the guns there, who actually became a Christian, that there was these two angels standing next to their vehicle. Really tall, 6-8 feet tall, whatever, big angels. And they were standing, they saw them. The missionary didn't see them, but they saw them, and they let them go. God can do some crazy stuff, right?
Amen.
And angels are there to minister to us. So, I mean, that I'm like, wow, that's crazy. God can, we have power when we pray. There's things that happen in the world, that's crazy stuff. So I'm going to share with you, out of the book of Revelation, chapter 5, we're going to go there first, and see how your prayers, that when you pray prayers, they're held in heaven in a bowl. And he looked to heaven as an incense. And God responds to this. And if you read, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but this is just before the seals are opened. This is just before all the curses are going to happen on the earth, all right? You can read about those later on. I'm not going to get into that too much. I want to show you verse, let's go to verse, chapter 5, verse 8 and 9 and 10. This is, and when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. So these elders, the 420 elders, are standing before the throne. Jesus is on the throne, and they're bowing down, and they're singing this song. And it says, and they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scrolls and to open the seals. They're talking about Jesus. Before you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God, for every tribe and language and people and nations. That's what I love about the Word of God. God's Word always includes every people group. It's not just the Jewish people. It's not just the Americans. It's everybody in the world God includes. It just blows my mind when people teach a different gospel than the gospel that's just for the whole world. Amen? You have made them to be a kingdom and a priest to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Then I looked and heard a voice of many angels numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 upon 10,000, and they encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, and I won't sing for you because I already told you I can't sing. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Hallelujah. Who's a songwriter here? Can you write this in our place? Right? Worthy is the Lamb of God who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory. This is Jesus. Jesus deserves everything because of what he did for us. Amen? And then I heard of every living creature in the heavens and on earth and under the earth and on the sea. I mean, every creature in all creation is praising and singing. So you can see the little fish in the ocean singing to God, right? All the birds are singing, right? Every creature upon the earth is singing. Don't laugh so hard at me. Like, come on, it's good, right? To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. The four living creatures said, Amen, and the elders fell down and he worshiped Jesus. Hallelujah. Can you get that picture in your mind? Jesus standing at the throne, all these angels, everybody worshiping Jesus because he is worthy to open up the seals that are going to happen next. But the thing that I really want to concentrate on is this verse 8. It says, they're holding bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And then they sang. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you again for your word. I pray, God, that you help me to just express how important it is for us to pray and the things that we need to pray for. Father, I ask that we are a people that know that we can't do nothing without you. Yes. And Father, even if we have everything we need, that we'll humble ourselves enough to pray to our God who is concerned about every soul across the whole world. Father, I thank you for that. In Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. So let's go to another chapter in the Bible, the book of Matthew. And this is where Jesus taught the disciples to pray. And how many of you have probably heard, if you've been in the church for any long time, you've heard this over and over and over and over. And even if you haven't been in church, you've heard this at funerals or weddings, or mostly at funerals, I guess, the Lord's Prayer. You ever hear the Lord's Prayer? I mean, if you live in America or probably anywhere in the world, you've heard this prayer where Jesus was talking to the disciples. And the disciples, it is interesting because the disciples were, as we are, learners of Jesus. That's what disciples mean. If I'm a disciple of Jesus, I want to learn about him. I want to be like him. I want to do things that he did. And so the disciples asked Jesus, because Jesus walked with his power. They recognized Jesus got away at night and spent time with God. And then during the day, he did things that were just miraculous. And we see him in Matthew, we see him through the Gospels, how he did miraculous things. I mean, eyes were open, crippled people walked, demon-possessed people were set free. I mean, it was just amazing things that Jesus, one story after another, you know. It was crazy. And the disciples saw that, and they asked Jesus, because they saw him go away to be with the Father, would you teach us how to pray? And so I think it's relevant for us today. I think if we don't have a prayer life and we want to learn how to pray, this would be a great example of how to pray. I don't want to beat you up today. I want to encourage you that if you would just take some time and pray, because our day, how many know our day are crazy? Nothing like Ashley's day. Listen, Ashley works a full-time job, just had twins, has a baby girl that's amazing, little Gracie, and a husband, and this lady, I mean, when is she going to have time to pray? I mean, she probably at the end of the day, correct me if I'm wrong, but you're like exhausted. I mean, I would be. Maybe you're not, but I would be, right? And so you're just like, you get up in the morning, it's not like you get up and spend an hour in prayer. You get up in the morning, you got to change some diapers, feed some babies, you know, get ready for work. I'm just, you know, I haven't been in your house, but I'm just thinking in my mind, because we had five children, so I can't relate, right? And she's going to work, she's probably busy at work. When do you have time? I don't know when you have time for it, but I know we should pray. Alright? I don't know when you can carve out time in your day. I'm not going to say you should pray an hour in the morning, or an hour at lunch, or an hour at 3 o'clock, we'll show you that later, or an hour before you go to bed, or 10 minutes, or whatever the time is. I'm not going to do that to you, because then that becomes rules, that becomes religion, and then we're not about that. But I know this, when we pray, our prayers are held up in heaven. And as we pray not so much for ourselves, but we pray for others, I see the power of God move in my life greater than that when I start praying for my selfishness. I need to rely on God, so I need God to help me to be a good husband, to manage my finances, to run the church. Well, I need God's help with all that. But I know when I pray for other people and other things, it just seems like something happens differently. I have a better understanding of the heart of God. When I pray for the lost here in Madison, as I was Uber driving for a little while, I did do some football games, so I'd go and pick up people late at night that were half alive, you know, from drinking all night. My heart broke, right? Or a young lady who got, you know, in a situation she shouldn't have been in, and she called Uber to pick her up, and I picked her up behind the stadium at the sitting on the fire hydrant thing. She was just waiting for me, sad. You know, I don't know what happened. I didn't ask her, but my heart broke. I can't drive Uber no more because of that. But I have a heart for my city that I never had before because I saw all the stuff that happens here. And so I pray for the young people that come to college at UW-Madison. I pray for the internationals that come to Madison. I pray for missionaries because I want to see. And when I do, something happens spiritually. Like, God seems to like take care of my stuff because I'm concerned about what he's concerned about over me. Because God said he'll take care of all my needs according to his riches and glory. So I don't really have to worry about myself. Can you say amen? Amen. That's hard to do. That means I need a reliance on God over everything else. He's going to take care of me. He's going to take care of all our needs. So let's look at this. Most of us know this, and I'm going to read it anyway. It's in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 9, if you're on your iPhone or your Bible app, or if you have a Bible. I was going to try and use my phone the whole time, but I just couldn't do it. I practiced with it, but it's like, oh, where's it going? Anyway, the verse says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. On earth as it is in heaven." That is so cool. So what's happening in heaven can also happen on earth. Yes. We know for one that there's praise going on in heaven like crazy, right? Yes. Angels were created to praise God. They're worshiping Jesus. They're thanking him. And then we find out later in Romans that Jesus is actually praying for you right now, making intercession for you. Jesus is always praying for you. Have you ever heard that before?
Yes.
He's praying for you right now. So if he's praying for you, we can pray to praise him. So one thing is when we praise the Father, because the Father, we have to go all the way back to Genesis, when God created man and woman. And it says that he created man and woman in his image. And then when man and women decided to sin, that they were separated from God, God never wanted to separate man from himself. God never wanted to punish man. God never wanted anyone to go to hell. He never created that for us. He created us for fellowship so we could be with him and walk with him and talk with him every day of our lives. How amazing is God? So when man fell, sin happened, and then there had to be somebody to be the perfect sacrifice, and that was Jesus. And he came and died for us. We're worshiping and thanking Jesus, our Father God, because of that. Amen? We thank God that he provided a way for us to come back to him. And now we can walk in peace and love and joy and happiness. We don't have to be stuck in the world. We can actually be happy, crazy Christians. Nobody's smiling, so we're probably not there. We can be happy as Christians. We can be happy as believers. We don't have to be stuck in the mud and, oh my God, here we got to go to church again. Pastor wants us a new work day, blah, blah, blah. You know, that's the world complaining. We don't have to be the complainer. We can be actually happy about this whole thing because we see life changing. The reason we don't, I said I was going to beat you up this morning, so I'm not going to. But the reason we don't is because we're not involved in the things of God.
That's right.
You can be a professor, you can be whatever you do, student, you can do all these things, but you're doing it for the glory of God. God put you in a place you are to bring his light to the world. So when you start changing the reason you're going to college, because I'm going to get a degree, obviously, get your degree, be the best, get A's, do the best you can, because in that you'll be the light of the world, amen? And in that you will change lives for the kingdom of God. And maybe you'll be persecuted for it. And maybe people make fun of you. But you know what? God has your back. Amen? And he's going to help you through that process if you pray. If you pray to him. So look at what else it says. It says, give us today our daily bread. Be thankful. We're not a thankful nation. We Everybody owes us, right? We're not thankful. Just be thankful for what you have. You have a good car or a bad car, whatever. Be thankful. You have good groceries or bad, be thankful. You live in a big house or a small, be thankful. When you have that attitude of Thanksgiving, oh my goodness, the peace of God flows over you, right?
Yes.
You're satisfied because God has provided for you. No matter, like Paul says, I was in need and I had wealth. I had everything. I mean, in every situation that anybody could be in, but in that, I gave him all the glory and praise because who he is. Hallelujah. Say amen. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Forgive us our debt as we forgive those who debt, as we forgive our debtors. Now, this reminds me of a story that I was in the Marine Corps for 20 years. And in the service, and I don't know if people do this today anymore because everybody's got charge cards, but back then, if somebody borrowed money from you, just say something that's like, because I had a corporal. I was a private, but he was a corporal and he needed some money. He said, I need to borrow $20 from you, and next payday I'll give you $40 back. That's a pretty good return, right? Right? So that's like, so I'm like, I was making $400 or $500 a month then, so, you know, I didn't have a lot of money, but I had $20 to give him because obviously he needed it, and I was a believer, so at this point I was thinking, well, okay, fine, here. So then the next payday, which is only about 10 days away, I thought I'd get $40. I mean, that'd be great. We could have grocery money, right? That's like awesome. Well, he didn't pay me that $40 one week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks down, right? Now I'm mad. Every time I see him, I'm mad, right? Because he outranks me, so I can't really, you know, say a whole lot, but still, you know, he owes me money. But as a new believer, I said, I can't be mad at this guy. So I started praying for him. You remember that, right? We just prayed for him. And the Lord says, I'll provide all that you need. And I was a new believer, so I kind of believed what God told me.
Right.
I mean, I didn't know any better, right? So I remember walking through the supply office, and he was there. We kind of, like, met. And I'm like, God says, okay, you're on. And I'm like, okay, God. And I said, listen, I want to tell you, I want to forgive you of the debt that you owe me. Because God forgave me of my debt. And he wasn't a believer yet, so he was like, what? You know, you're crazy. You know? I said, no, really, because every time I see you, I get mad at you because you owe me money. And I don't want to do that anymore. I said, I want to release you for what you owe me. You don't owe me any money anymore. And I wish I could stand and tell you today he's a Christian. I don't know. But I know that the Lord told me that I need to forgive, and I did. And when I forgave, the peace came over me, right? And I didn't have to carry that burden of anger about that situation anymore. Now I can love him like God loves him, because now I don't look at him because he owes me $40, right? It's a difference. Praise the Lord. So let's go on. Anybody getting anything on this yet? Okay.
Yeah.
And he leads us not into temptation, but he delivers us from the evil. How many know that everyone here in this room is being tempted every day?
Yes.
Every day you're being tempted to not serve God and not to believe God. Enemy wants to say, all those words that pastor's speaking, all the words I read in the Bible, they're not true. That's just somebody wrote that. You know, there's a lot of mistakes in the Bible. No, the Holy Spirit's always a teacher, and he's always leading you to truth. If you just allow him. As you pray, you say, God, lead me not into temptation. Don't let me be tempted to do something ethically wrong. How many business people I have here? You know, and you can easily do something that's, you know, nobody's going to know anyway. Right? But guess what? You got to do the right thing, because, listen, we're tempted to always do wrong. And then it says here, deliver us from the evil one. I mean, as much as the Holy Spirit is guiding and leading you and directing you every day, same as the enemy is trying to destroy you and pull you down and pull you back and pull you into unbelief. That's why one of my common prayers that I pray for myself is, Lord, help my unbelief. Mm-hmm. It's scriptural. Anybody else pray that?
Yeah.
It's me. You know, I sometimes struggling in life and stuff like that, it gets really difficult, and I want to believe God over anything else that the world has offered.
Yeah.
And so sometimes I have to pray, like, God, I'm really, you know, I'm not really trusting you right at the moment, right? Can I just be honest with you? We're not perfect. We're still trying to work towards that, and that's, I know that you're perfect, but nobody else probably is as perfect as you are, but we're striving to be like Linda. All right, or actually, we're striving to be like Jesus. It's helpful to have good examples around us, right?
Yes.
We're talking about prayer. Jesus is teaching the disciples how to pray. So if he's taught them how to pray, I think this would be a good start. If you don't have a prayer life or prayer time, this is just a good place to start. All right, this is because you don't have to pray a certain prayer. This is not a prayer as we have used over centuries now, that we have made this into a prayer. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with praying the scripture. Hear my heart on this. But just praying. Mm-hmm. Praying is just talking to God. You know, I restarted my prayer life a couple years ago. I was really struggling. It seemed like every time I prayed, I was just like, I wasn't getting nowhere. Like, I was just talking on a, just the, like the prayers were going up the ceiling and bouncing back. Like, I was getting nowhere. And it was months after months had happened. And I met a gentleman that I trust in the Lord, a pastor friend of mine. And I said, hey, I'm really struggling praying. I just, like, I want to pray. I lay on the floor in my office and I fall asleep for hours, you know. I come in here and fall asleep on the floor, you know. That's what the pastors do when nobody knows what they do. But we take lots of naps. And it's restful, man. It's very amazing. But I'm praying. I'm getting nowhere. I'm like talking to the ceiling. And so he said, take a chair. And I'm going to take this chair. And so take a chair and just sit in front of the chair. And then that's, and just pretend that's God right there.
Yeah.
Do you ever do that? So I did for months. I would come here in the morning and I'd talk to God. And we would talk, you know. Now I don't have to do that anymore. But it just, I needed something to help me because it was like I had this block. And it's just, God wants to talk to you, right? Is that crazy? You guys think, Castrova, I'm never going back to that church. You guys are nuts. But yeah, I am. And it's okay. When, in 2005, when I came here, the church was like, had half the people that we have now. When we came, our family doubled the church. So that was like, we had great growth our first year. I was sitting over here, I was laying on the floor over here, and I was praying. I said, God, this city, Madison, is a big city. It's not really a big city when you compare it to Chicago or like when we're in Southern California. All that. But it's a big city, and I was praying, God, what does this church need to do for your kingdom? He told me two things. And I'm praying. I mean, as I'm telling you, we have to pray. I cannot get a vision. I can't capture what God wants for you. You can't, you don't understand what you'll just run in circles trying to figure out what God wants for your life if you don't ask Him, right? And so I'm asking God, what do we do here? And He said two things. This house will be a house of prayer for all nations. Amen. So I said, okay, God, we're going to teach our people how to pray. And for years, I've taught different models of prayer so people can just get excited about prayer. But I can't do anything to get people excited about prayer. This is the Lord's Prayer model. We teach that. And then we taught on the tabernacle prayer. We taught all these different ways to pray to help people pray. And guess what? You know, it comes out to you just have to pray.
Yeah.
Right? There's not a model. God doesn't want you to do a certain prayer. He just wants to talk to you. He wants you to talk to Him. And when you do, all of a sudden things begin to change in our perspective. I need you to pray for me. I was talking to Pastor Andrew, and he's held preaching at another church because the pastor's out on vacation this week, but he's on Madison Church, so pray for him. But we need you to pray for us. Because we don't want to do religion. We just want to do God. Right? That's why we say this is a building. We don't call this a church. These four walls. This is like our living room to me. You sit in my living room, we sit down and have a meal, and we talk about Jesus. This is why I love doing this, right? But was that, we need you to pray for us. We need God's direction every day.
Yes.
As we pray for you, because we guarantee we pray for you. Last night we prayed, we had a prayer last night. It was in the bulletin about 4 weeks. We had five of us show up last night for prayer. So we prayed for, praise God, we had five people show up for prayer. It's like if you have a meal, everybody shows up for a meal, but you have prayer, nobody shows up. I don't get it, really. I don't get it. Because you don't get a chance to talk to God together. And we did. We talked to God. We prayed for everybody in the church. It was great. It was just the presence of God and all that kind of stuff. And I'm saying, I just want you to just come. We're just going to do it once a month. We're going to try to be a house of prayer. We used to do it every other week here on a Friday night. And then on Saturday night, we pray. Because we know that we can't be effective in the city of Madison without prayer. Right? And it doesn't mean we have the answer. Capital City Church is not the answer for Madison. We can join with other churches, but we have to do certain things, right? And be more effective in the city of Madison. Because the major thing is not about lifting up Capital City Church in this city. And that's what happens when we don't pray. When we don't pray as a church, we wanna put our brand out there. We wanna exalt Capital City Church. But you know, my heart and Pastor Andrew's heart is that we lift up Jesus. And when we lift up Jesus in our city, when we love like Jesus loves, and we help the poor like Jesus helped the poor, and we lay hands on the sick like Jesus did, all of a sudden then we see people lifting up, coming to Jesus, not the Capital City Church.
Right?
Right? That's hard for a pastor to say. I want the church, I want the pews filled, I want everybody here, I want the offerings to be huge. I want, no, no. I want, listen to me, because of this prayer, when I was there, Jesus said, the second thing he said too was that this will be a house of prayer for all nations. And the second thing he said, that we're going to reach the nations through this church. And I thought to myself, well, how are we going to reach the nations through Capital City Church? We're like five people. There's just, it's impossible for us to reach the nations through this church, but we have. And we see many different countries, nations represented, and people come to Jesus through our ministry because we said we're going to lift up Jesus over Capital City Church. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, this is good stuff. This is truth, right? Think about it. I'm telling you, if you lift up Jesus, then God's going to draw people to himself.
Right.
It's nothing that we can do. We can have the best band. We can have the best preacher, whatever, sermon. Whatever. And then, you know, we had the best offering. We had all the best stuff. But you know what? People can just come to an event. We're not coming to an event. We're coming to build you up in Christ Jesus, help you, encourage you to pray to God so God can use you in your world to reach your kingdom for his kingdom. Amen? Exalt Jesus wherever you are, in your area where you live. Are all your neighbors saved? Are all your classmates saved? Are people you know, are they saved? No. Well, you know what? That's your mission field. Everywhere you go and everywhere you meet is your mission field. You ever hear that before?
Yes.
Amen. You know it's true. Also, okay, let's talk about prayer. Just a little bit further, I got about four or five different scriptures I want to share with you. And one of them is, this is interesting, this is for you, for the widows in the audience. So Luke 2:37 says Anna was in the temple every day, night and day praying. So I'm going to give you a key to the building. You can come here anytime you want.
Okay.
I'm serious. I need people praying for the ministry of Capital City Church. And like, doesn't have to just be widows, but I need everybody. But since Linda, you know, she doesn't have anybody to take care of right now, right? So if she wants to spend some time in the temple praying, then I'm going to offer it up to you. To pray, amen? And that just, you know, it's just something, because what happened back in that day, and this is probably for the church overall, the temple was where the widows, because the husband brought all the income in, so the widows came to the temple because the temple took care of the widows. So they housed them, they fed them, and did to cover all their needs. And that's why Anna was in the temple at the time, waiting for Jesus to be revealed after his birth. And so this is a good example, maybe that we could open up the church all the time for people that want to pray. Maybe we can even, if you don't have, maybe we'll just like open up a church early in the morning if people wanted to come and pray. So if you go to work at 7 o'clock and you want to come here at 6 to pray, then I'll give you a combination of the door so you can come in. Anyway, or I can meet you here and pray with you. But you know what I'm saying? There's no reason why you can't come. If you want to come to church and pray, you let me know and I'll give you access to the building so you can come in here and pray. Amen? I want you to be able to do that because I know sometimes it's hard to find a place to be by yourself with God. The early church prayed. Let's look at the early church. This is just an example. Again, I don't want to duplicate this. I want to do what God wants us to do here in Madison. But look at Acts chapter 1 in verse 14. It said they all joined together continuously in prayer, constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary and the mother of Joseph of Jesus and his brothers. So they were continuously in prayer. And then in Acts 2:42, it says that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship in the breaking of bread and prayer. So anytime the saints came together, they prayed. So I like to pray when we come together, even on Sunday morning. I want to pray for your needs. We're going to do that at the end of the service. I want to be able to see God move in your life. They devote themselves to prayer. Look at the centurion, Acts chapter 10. This is a really awesome story. This is not a... Remember, the early church were all Jewish people, right? Jesus came. All the apostles were Jewish. The beginning of the church, they were in the habit of praying. They were praying out of religious obligation. That was part of what they did. But then when the Spirit came on...